So as we get ready to count down to Pesach, it's worthwhile considering one of the less obvious, but certainly most paramount lessons to take away from the festival of Pesach. There's a very curious law in the Torah where we are instructed, Lo tita'ev mitzri, do not oppress the Egyptian. Why? Kiger ha'yisa, because you were strangers in their land. By definition, you were refugees in their land. And as one of the classic commentaries, Rashi points out, even though they subjected us to all kinds of persecution, even though they took our firstborn males and threw them in the river, ultimately, in the first instance, when there was a hunger in the land of Canaan and Jacob's family needed to seek refuge, Egypt was their home. Egypt gave them that refuge. That in itself, therefore, warrants that notwithstanding whatever else happened to us, we shouldn't oppress the Egyptian. Obviously, we're referring to further generations down, and it reflects a certain reality about how we need to always be utterly grateful for any kind of graciousness that is shown to us. It's a principle that is paramount in life, to always consider the goodness that somebody else shows us and to always therefore be grateful for that goodness. You know, the verse in Jeremiah tells us that we should always seek out the well-being and the welfare of any city or country that is responsible for exiling us. Here again, quite curious. I mean, they exiled us. But nevertheless, right now, we might be refugees in their land. Let's consider how Babylon was responsible for exiling the Jewish people, destroying the temple, but ultimately, the Jewish people set up home there, they established yeshivot over there, they continued to thrive and to flourish there for many, many years. There's a wonderful story told about Rabbi Aryeh Levin, who was otherwise known as the righteous, the tzaddik of Jerusalem, of Yerushalayim. And he told a story to his own disciples about how when he was younger, he studied in the famous yeshiva of Slobodka. And he became a personal friend, as it were, and study partner of the head of the dean of that particular yeshiva, Rabbi Baruch Ber Libovitch. And there was a point in time when he turned around and asked his teacher or his mentor and his study partner for a letter of recommendation because he wanted to transfer out to another yeshiva, the yeshiva of Volozhin. It was a very painful moment, he said, of his life, and he never explained why he wanted to transfer. But when his students pressed him, he told them, because in those days it was the case that you didn't typically stay in a yeshiva dormitory. The yeshiva could not afford to house or feed all the boys, so they were reliant on many different members of the community to provide the home or provide the food. And in the particular home in which he stayed, he said the gentleman who was responsible for him used to bother him, used to oppress him, used to antagonize him sometimes about his own learning, to a point where he just felt he couldn't carry on anymore and he needed to move on. So why didn't you, ask his students, just simply ask to be moved to a different home? To which he replied, but what of all the gratitude? What of all the kindness that this man had shown me? He gave me a bed, he gave me a roof, he gave me food. It would be wrong to besmirch him to the yeshiva. And so it was simpler, or more right, if you will, to move on somewhere else, to a different yeshiva instead. Moshe, Moses, is so called because Ki min hamayim mishisihu, because I drew him from the water, said Pharaoh's daughter. And there were a number of different interpretations or explanations on the significance of this name. But above all else, the Medrash tells us that inasmuch as Moshe had many different names, God chooses to call him specifically by this name that Pharaoh's daughter gave him, which reflects, again, the gratitude towards Pharaoh's daughter for giving Moshe that salvation, for saving him indeed ultimately from the water. Contrast this with Pharaoh. Pharaoh, the Torah tells us, was like a new king who didn't remember Yosef. There are two things outstanding about Pharaoh. Number one, he didn't remember Yosef. Isn't Joseph the one who brought refuge to the whole country of Egypt? Wasn't he the one who was responsible for ensuring that the economy was spared in the face of all that hunger? And yet, when it's convenient, when it's right, this king makes himself like a new king. Pharaoh chooses to forget the goodness that Joseph demonstrated when helping save the Egyptian economy. And number two, one of the things that Joseph's father Jacob blessed Pharaoh with was that whenever he would come to the Nile and he would stand there at the waters would rise up towards him. And yet, as we know, when God instructs Moses to go to bring about the plagues, He tells him to meet Pharaoh by the water because Pharaoh presented himself like a demigod and he would make a deliberate point of relieving himself always in those same waters, which would otherwise bring typical blessing to his land. Indeed, the Midrash tells us whoever denies the goodness that another person shows them is as though they deny the goodness of God himself. Appreciate the people in your life. Appreciate the things in your life that bring goodness to your life. Always recognize it for what it is. Always show your appreciation. And yes, maybe sometimes when someone does something bad towards you, you're quick to pounce because after all, hey, here's an opportunity for me to no longer have to feel indebted to them. But no. Never throw stones into the well from which you drink, says the Talmud. Always appreciate all the goodness that is in your life. There's a lot of lessons we can learn from the Exodus of Egypt. This is perhaps a less obvious one, but nevertheless an equally exceptionally important one. To always appreciate the goodness, to always appreciate the good people, to always appreciate the good things, to always appreciate the divine hand that brings those things and those people into your life, and to therefore go forward with a sense of contentment and fulfillment in your life ahead. Shabbat Shalom and Chag Sameach.